A little bit what we did in the first lecture. So this is the basic object in a diagram. And so let me recall the setting. So we have a semi-simple complex Lie algebra G with a Cartan subalgebra, and we had corresponding complex simply connected Lie group and corresponding Cartan subgroup. In there, we fix the representation of G. So, for simplicity, throughout these lectures, just being a finite dimensional complex analytic representation. And then we defined the space of just the trace functions, S valued and analytic functions on G, which are representatives of matrix coefficients of the finite dimensional representations of G, which are invariant under the action of G, where G acts via the conjugation action on this function space, and just via the representation S in the second function. Okay. And we have seen that, so this is the space of sigma-twisted trace functions. We have seen that spanned by sort of the following form. So you take a trace of the action of G colored with a intertwiner phi from some G, another G representation M to M tensor S, right? I call those vertex operators because they are somehow related, kind of a limit to vertex operators in conformal field theory. A kind of picture to have in mind, and I try to explore this more today, is like this. You have a circle or a cycle cycle graph with one vertex. So you color the edge with the representation M, which plays kind of the role of auxiliary space. You have an open-ended vertex sticking out, an open-ended edge, I mean, sticking out at the vertex. This vertex is colored by the intertwiner. And in addition, the edge is colored by the group element. And you can think of that as somehow choosing a G connection on this graph, on this very simple graph. So what did we do also? Maybe finally just remarking that this sigma twisted space, or this space of sigma twisted trace functions, decomposes in elementary ones, meaning that so the matrix coefficients arising in the expansion are coming from just the matrix coefficients of an irreducible representation. Or if you like, you can characterize them in terms of the action of bi-invariant differential operators. Simultaneous eigenspace decomposition for the action of the bi-invariant differential operators, but this is the central character of the irreducible representation. Okay, and so we started with looking at the restriction map from this space of sigma twisted trace functions to just Laurent polynomials, tensor product with you land in the zero weight space of your representation S. And one of the key things to do to relate it, for instance, to quantum integrable systems is to try to compute how the action of bi-invariant differential operators on this space of sigma twisted trace functions can be put into in terms of differential operators on the image of this restriction. Okay, so that's where we are at. Okay, is everybody? Okay. All right, so let's continue with discussion this radial component. We have a root space decomposition. I need a little bit of structure theory and some notations for that. So you have the root space decomposition. And for Lambda in the dual of the Cartan, I think fix the corresponding element in a Cartan subalgebra, which corresponds to Lambda through the Killing form, identifying H with H dual via the Killing form. So I'll just fix the root vectors E alpha such that E alpha, the Lie bracket of E alpha with E minus alpha is T alpha. And finally, I'll just fix an basis of a basis wage, the Cartan subalgebra, which are orthonormal with respect to the Killing form. Okay, and the latter thing you can, of course, do because there is a real form of the Cartan subalgebra such that the Killing form restricts to a scalar product on that. Then let's consider a space of differential operators. So a space of differential operators on H with coefficients being linear maps from the zero weight space of your fixed representation S to S. And so I'm allowing rational trigonometric coefficients. So Q here is just the Gaussian field of Laurent polynomials, which is here in the image of the restriction map. And inside of here, the subspace with coefficients CM now taking values in just the endomorphism space of the zero weight space. Okay, so they preserve this zero weight space. And this, of course, now turns into an algebra of differential operators. And so now the radial component map, what do we like to have? So what we like to have is, so we want to find for X in the universal enveloping algebra, or just for any, say, G invariant differential operator, I want to find a special operator on H in the subspace, such that if I act by X on F as just a left invariant differential operator, and I restrict this to H, that this will be just this differential operator on H acting on the restriction of F to H. And this should be true for all. It is just pushing through the action of the right invariant differential, left invariant differential operator on trace functions, pushing that through to an action of a differential operator on its radial component. All right, so how can you find such a beast and prove that it exists, and how can you compute with it? And that's a computation I just want to give because it's really, I think, the key computation of the whole lecture series. Let's put some pressure on it. So let's try to find an inductive formula. So let's look at X times the root vector E alpha acting on a twisted trace function, but I know that is always of the form like this, some vertex operator. So I want to compute this restricted to this Cartan subgroup. So now I'm going to draw pictures. I'm not sure whether it's quicker than actually writing formulas, but I think it helps to just understand what you're doing. There's a kind of a topological computations at the background. from graphical calculus, and actually it turns out that you can really understand such computations in terms of these kind of logistic and derive graphical calculus methods. And that becomes actually especially apparent as soon as you do it for on the quantum group level. And there's actually a paper out just 2 days ago, myself with Restikin and Hardeweg de Klerk, who is explaining some first steps in that. And Hardeweg will be talking about it next week on Monday. So everybody's invited. So that's the advertisement. Okay, and so now you can compute. And I make myself my life a little bit easier because I just keep on working with the same picture. So the ELF, I move to the other side. At the cyclicity of the trace. So the game to play is to just try to relate. So the ELF is here on the right hand side of X, and I just want to get it on the left hand side of X. Of this universal enveloping hour, this arbitrary element X. So I just move it now through the trace to the other side, and I'm just going to push it through until it's at its spot. Okay, so now I'm hitting my intertwiner. So that means that I'm getting two steps. And I cannot just push it through. So before pushing it through, I should correct it and get the same kind of diagram where the E alpha is also on top. And then I can push these two E alphas through to a single E alpha on the left of phi. Phi is an intertwiner, so it's an intertwiner of the algebra representations. So the action of G on the tensor product is the sum of the action on the first component plus the sum on the second component. So I should take minus E alpha. And then plus, so now I'm getting overheated. Stop use. I'm not colorblind. Now we just need to interchange E alpha with H, but that's E alpha is just a root factor. So that's okay. So I can just replace this by H. Well, minus alpha, I get H E alpha over here. Okay, and so now I've moved it to the other side. So what is the consequence of this computation? This is minus the action of E alpha on this spin space of this twisted trace function restricted to H. And then I get, I'm going to correct this one step more. So I'm just going to take this as a sum of two. I'm just taking the commutator of those two and then plus the original guy, where it's in the original form, which disappeared, where the E alpha is again on the right of E alpha, but then it has this factor H to the power minus alpha. So I get H minus alpha. X E alpha. So you get still one more correction. Does this help? So if you're just thinking in terms of the degree on the universal enveloping algebra coming from the natural filtration on U of G, then you see that you have lowered the degree of the elements on the right hand side by one. So this gives an inductive way to actually get to compute the radial component by decreasing the degree of the element with which you are acting. I've done it here for the element, the root factor, a similar kind of computation you can do for an element in the Cartan subalgebra. Okay, so believe this and, yes, that's right. So I'm going to formulate it now. Let me now try to collect some stuff. Maybe Pavel, you can say.
Yes.
Whether I should.
No. It's very simple.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So it's just
as. I wasn't around yet, and Kirillov wasn't around.
No, I know, but this kind of method of computing the radial components in the group cases. Yeah, but I didn't put my name on. So that's it. But this way of computing the radial component in this specific case of trace functions, that is due to you and Kirillov. This computation you can find in Kirillov's thesis. So there exists a unique linear map, universal enveloping algebra to this space of differential operators. Satisfying on properties. So here's the formula. If you do it for a Catan element, if you compute this differential operator for an element of the form x times y, where y is an element in the Catan subalgebra, then it should be minus the action of y on the spin space Lx sigma, plus the derivative, the directional derivative on H in the direction Y, Lx of sigma. And then for the root vectors, it's the formula I just wrote. So I almost wrote down, right? So you just have to take this part, subtract this part, and then divide by 1 minus h to the power minus alpha. Okay. So you get the formula sigma alpha, the multiplicative character of minus alpha minus 1. Now x sigma plus 1 over xi alpha minus 1 of L of E alpha. And we take fx sigma. Right, and that's guy. So this is really the radial component map, and so the justification is that it does on sigma twisted trace functions what you would like to do. So for all x, for all twisted trace functions, we will have that acting by x as a left invariant differential operator on f restricted to h is the same as applying this differential operator to the restriction of f to h. Okay. And the third thing is, so what happens if you restrict to the center? So that is that the linear map restricts to an algebra map from the center of the universal enveloping algebra to this algebra of differential operators with this restricted coefficient set, where actually the weight zero subspace is preserved by the coefficient. But that is reflected by the fact that if you act by central elements on a sigma twisted trace function, it remains a sigma twisted trace function. It isn't true if you act by any left invariant differential operator. That's why you get coefficients which drop out of the zero weight condition. If you act by the center, it is okay. And so this now immediately, you can think of this as.
So this is part one, yes? You have one, but there is no one.
Ah. Yeah. Now it is. Okay, so. Example, so it's now easy to compute example. Well, of course, if you just take x to be an element in the universal enveloping algebra of H, then of course L of x is just going to be the corresponding constant coefficient differential operator on H. So that's easy. So if you compute what the radial component is of the action of just the root vector, then of course that is also easy by the second formula. If you plug in x is equal to 1, this one drops out. Okay, so you get just the action of EL from the spin space divided by xi minus alpha minus 1. This is an example where, of course, the zero weight condition is not preserved by the coefficient of your constant differential operator. So a little bit more exciting, but with a reason, you can now compute L of E minus alpha E alpha just by doing two steps of this formula. The second step you actually have already done in two. And so you get a first order differential operator, 1 over xi alpha minus 1, the directional derivative in T alpha minus xi alpha minus 1 squared of the action of E alpha times E minus alpha on the spin space. Okay, so I invite you to check that formula. And so now you can compute directly the radial component of the Casimir element. This particular choice of root vectors I've taken it at the start. Why is that the Casimir element, quadratic Casimir element, takes this form? And noticing that you have a basis of the Lie algebra and a corresponding dual basis, where for the dual basis the root vector is interchanged with its negative, with the root vector for the corresponding negative. And so as a consequence, you can compute the component of the action of the Casimir. And that takes this form. So it's a bit big formula, but I think for the moment it will be the biggest. So delta here is the Laplacian. Of course, coming from this Cartan term in the Casimir, this first remark over here, that is producing the Laplacian. And these guys, it's radial component we have just computed. So it's just collecting the things we have computed in this example. Okay, and so you recognize that this is almost a Hamiltonian of a quantum detectable system, with this being the potential, and think of one over sine hyperbolic squared. If you think of this operator as an operator acting on the real split form of your maximal torus, you can think of it as one over sine squared. If you are viewing this as an operator on the compact torus, and so these are kind of hyperbolic or trigonometric quantum collodion Moser systems, where this is just the Hamiltonian, and the higher Hamiltonians arise from higher Casimirs in the center. And so it is factor valued, or if you like, a spin type of quantum collodion Moser system, because this is acting now on the zero weight space of the spin space, which does not have to be one dimension.
So you can remove the first derivative term by conjugating by the final derivative.
That was my next remark. Yeah. So you okay? Indeed, it's you want to remove that in order for really to view it as a Hamiltonian, right? So taking a wild denominator, where rho is just the half sum of positive root, conjugating, well, let me write it like this, so minus a half, conjugating this radial component of the action of the Casimir by, and repairing a constant, this will be now really a Hamiltonian in the usual sense of the word, so minus a half Laplacian plus this potential term. And so that means actually that eigenstates for this quantum integrable system can now be obtained by taking a twisted trace function, an elementary twisted trace function, and multiply it by Q, by this while denominator that will produce simultaneous eigenfunctions for this Hamiltonian, but also for the corresponding higher Hamiltonians. And so that gives the representation theoretic way to actually solve this intractable system. So I don't want to keep on talking about this, so let me maybe close here. Maybe one last remark, and that's kind of a very nice application of this whole theory. So if you do this for SLN, you take for your spin space a suitable symmetric power of just the vector representation, where actually depends on an integer k, then actually, and you do this computation, then actually this the zero weight space of that representation is one dimensional. So then this turns out to be just really an Hamiltonian operator of Kalojo-Moser type, where just this operator is replaced by a scalar depending on this natural number k. And then the corresponding eigenstates are expressed in terms of check polynomials. This natural number k is, say, the check parameter, the extra parameter in the check polynomials. Okay. Check polynomials. Yeah, so the classical limits of the MacDonald polynomial. And of course, this all lives to the quantum group setting, and then you get MacDonald. Okay, so next topic will be endpoint twisted trace functions. Basic idea here is that if you look at these trace functions and your representation, your spin representation is actually a tensor product, say, of n representations of the group G with its diagonal action, then the space of sigma twisted trace functions has extra symmetries, leading in particular to Hamiltonians, many more Hamiltonians to analyze. So Hamiltonians which commute with the Hamiltonians we have constructed before. Family of Hamiltonians parametrized by central elements and the index running from one to n. And if you just compare computing the quadratic Hamiltonians over here is kind of the interesting thing. And if you look at the difference of the two quadratic Hamiltonians for indices close by, then you can express them by first order differential operators, which will be KCB operators, leading to first order differential operators, KCB type of operator. And so I would like to try to explain that. And let me start off with a little bit kind of a very general. So let's have an oriented graph, vertex at V and edge at E. Then the product group, when you take the product of group, the number of vertices copies of the group G is acting now on the product group labeled by the edge set by the following formula. So let's take an A on the line in this G sub V. So it is a group element for each vertex in this gauge GE. S is an E. Then the action is taking a fixed edge E, taking the group element GE, and then left multiplied by the element H of its starting point, the source of the arrow, and taking over here the inverse of the group element associated with the target of the edge. If you want to think a little bit more fancy, then you can think of this as being the space of G connections on the graph, gamma. And this is just the gauge group acting on the space of G connections.
Work with
finite oriented graphs, right?
Yeah. Actually, I'm going to specialize to a very special graph. So this is a little bit maybe overdone, but actually, it's the best way to write down the action. So I'm going to apply it to a special case, and that is. So we worked for now here with this cycle graph of one vertex. So now we are just taking a cycle graph with n vertices. And so this will be the edge E1, E2, etc. And this will be E0, which is En. So I'm reading the indices modulo n. So then you can identify, of course, this vertex set and this edge set with just the set of integers between 1 and n. And if you then look what is the corresponding action, and it is this kind of strange conjugation action, multi-point conjugation action. And so now let's take sigma to be just sigma underline, just to be the representation of the direct product group G n times on the tensor product representation. We can define now the space of endpoint listed trace functions to be, and there we go. So we take the representative functions on this direct product of groups G, and then tensor product with this representation as underline, and then I take the invariance with respect to the gauge group. So there, if you like, there are the functions on the G connections on the graph, taking values in my representation S bar. So that's a representation of the gauge group. And I'm taking the G invariance of that. So you can think of that as, if you like, as a space of sections on some vector bundle on the moduli space of G connections on the graph. If you take capital N equal to 1, then you're back to sigma twisted trace functions as before. This decomposes again in elementary blocks by just restricting to the functions where these are coefficients of the corresponding irreducible representation of this product group. And just in a second, we will see that this is a simultaneous eigenspace decomposition for a natural action on this. So this all looks fine, and but after this lemma, you probably think that I've wasted your time, because this space is just isomorphic to taking the twisted trace functions on G with respect to just the tensor product of these N representations, viewed as a G representation with the diagonal action of G on it. So as a space, it is actually nothing different than what we studied before, just with a very particular spin representation, which already is a tensor product of some other spin representation, right? But this will give a refinement of the decomposition of this in elementary blocks. So the proof, so the map is very easy to construct. So it's just plugging in once every entry except for the last entry, and then you plug in the group element. If you want to see its inverse, or if you just start with such an endpoint twisted trace function, you want to make it into a. If you start with a one point, just a twisted trace function, and you want to turn it in an endpoint one, then it corresponds to just the signatristic trace function evaluated in the product of the group elements, and then twisted by actions on the spin space. And this is something you can check very easily. This gauge group is enormous, and with this gauge group you easily see, for instance, that any element in this N, so an N tuple of group elements can lies in the orbit of the element where you have all ones and over here just the product of the group elements. That's the key thing to check. Now, so this picture helps to actually get additional actions of the center on the space. Okay, so let's just start with any S bar valued function on this product group. And then you can just define the coordinate action of the universal enveloping algebra on it. So this is just acting by x on the jth coordinate as a left invariant differential operator. And so that gives a action of the n-fold tensor product of the universal enveloping algebra on the space of vector valued functions. And the restriction of this action to the n-fold tensor product of the center will preserve this space of endpoint sigma twisted trace function. Preserves this space. And so you can now characterize these refined blocks, elementary blocks, as eigenfunctions. This action of this n-fold tensor product of the center. Spectrum just described in terms of the central characters of the irreducible representations corresponding to your choice of elementary block. Okay, so now there's a little proposition. There's another way. So we know, so by this lemma, we actually know already how all these endpoint twisted trace functions look like, because they are just endpoint twisted or just twisted trace functions like here. So you can construct them by taking a trace over a vertex operator. Yeah. Looking at these refined blocks, you get another description of this space of endpoint trace functions. So if you take irreducible representations by I from one up to n, then we have a linear isomorphism of the following tensor product of intertwining spaces. So you are just running through your cycle graph, and at each vertex you are picking up an intertwiner. So this is the vertex you pick up at the vertex n, this one at two, and this one at one. And there's a linear isomorphism of this to this elementary block. The following, so you take product of n of these vertex operators, and this map trace function corresponding to the composition of these n vertex operators. So I will write this copy like this. It's just the composition of these operators, but you need to note that, of course, you're landing with this intertwiner in a tensor product of a auxiliary space and a spin space. And then the next intertwiner is only acting on this auxiliary space and not on the spin space. So every time you are adding such an intertwiner, you are adding a spin space, which is left untouched when moving through this composition of intertwiners. So this will be a from Mn to Mn tensor, this tensor product. Right? And then this is, if you like, the corresponding So it's a trace function, which you can also think of as an endpoint. This is a trace function. Pictures are very helpful here. Kind of good to think of this as endpoint vertex operators. How is of this endpoint vertex operator? Right, so it's open-ended still, and then there are these spin spaces that is created at each step. And so this trace function, which is in this isomorphism, so if you think, if you push that through this linear isomorphism to really make it into a, sorry, 1 second. This is bad, but I, but let me get this picture out. So it is so we're just putting a G1 over here. G2, Gn. So it is it's just taking the trace over this auxiliary space which are sticking out. So Mn, phi one of G1, phi two of G2. And if you know something about field theory, they start looking like correlation functions very much. So you can really think of these as endpoint correlations or some topological limit of those. So what I will do tomorrow, sorry that I'm over time, is to write additional differential equations for, say, the radial component of these endpoint functions and get the KCP operators out. Then, as a second step, we are not going to take this trace as kind of the closure of the auxiliary spaces, but we are going to take other matrix coefficients of this product, the vertex operators, related to say harmonic analysis, and try to understand the corresponding important spherical functions. That will be, I think, the last lecture. So thank you.
Questions and comments? Oh, I think we'll thank again, Jasper, and thank you.